Building on that, I do want to stop and talk a little bit about how we're going to speak about high and low kids in our class. So the language we use about tracking and related things about kids learning is often really damaged, and we sort of talk ourselves into these really damaging beliefs about kids. I guarantee that you will work now and or in the future in schools where there are high and low classes or groups. They may go by different names, but they will exist. You're probably going to hear kids referred to as high kids, low kids, gifted kids, IEP kids, and other related terms. And frankly, you'll be able to go into classrooms and observe, and you'll be able to make a guess. If you wanted to, you'll be able to watch for a while and make a guess about who you think might be in the high group and who the teacher would say is in the low group. And if you were to ask the teacher, you'd probably be right. And all of these are going to reinforce how you think about kids and your beliefs about them. And these labels end up being really damaging. So first off, as I said, they're based on a really narrow definition of mathematics. It really only works when the math people are learning is very narrowly defined. But more importantly, they lead kid teachers to treat kids differently. Maybe you call on different kids for different kinds of questions. Maybe when someone answers it correctly, you act more or less surprised. Maybe when someone makes a small error, you treat it like a little mistake versus a real misunderstanding. There's lots of different ways that teachers, even subconsciously, are sending this message to kids, and kids pick up on it. It leads to them thinking differently about themselves and about their peers. I guarantee the kids know. We've studied it, and you can see it in classrooms. You'll see kids get put in a group for, say, reading or math or whatever, and they say, "Oh, I'm in the dumb group," or something like that. They have an idea of what group they're in, and it affects how they think about themselves and each other. And then it affects how they act and engage in the classroom. So the kids who are labeled as high are treated as good at math. They raise their hand more, they participate more. When they're in a small group and they suggest something, other people in the group listen to them, and therefore their ideas get to come out and be worked on more, and their math takes center stage. And other kids who are labeled as low or not as smart in mathematics learn that they don't have a lot to contribute. They don't raise their hand as much. Sometimes they're working in a group and they have a brilliant idea and they share it and no one listens to them. And therefore, the group, everyone in the group misses out. They miss out on their thinking and engaging with their thinking in a meaningful way. And that's really damaging to kids. And eventually they just withdraw and they don't participate. They learn more or they learn less. Their thinking doesn't get worked on as much in the classroom and they don't learn as much. So part of what we want to really think about is that what we're doing is we're teaching kids that they're either high or low. It's not something about the kids, but it's something about what we teach them and how we interact with them. So what we want to do is practice different ways of talking, and therefore hopefully that will help us develop different ways of thinking about kids. There's two big ways that I want to try to help us talk our ways to new beliefs, and I will try to call you out if you do this and help you practice different ways of doing it. So the central thing, or one of the biggest parts of our course, is going to be starting with student strengths and thinking about real specific learning goals. So statements like "my students can't multiply" are not very productive. First off, it's framing students in terms of a deficit, what they don't have. It also shows a probably a pretty limited understanding of what multiplication can be or look like. Instead, we want to get more specific, and we also want to start with a strength. So I might say Matt can add, Matt's good at adding, and therefore I can build on that to help him learn how to multiply, say through repeated addition as a foundation. That does two things. First off, it frames Matt in terms of what he can do, and second, it helps him, or it provides me real information about how I can move forward as a teacher. So that's one of the things we're going to practice, is really framing kids in terms of their strengths. Another thing, though, is that we will have to talk about schools. I've talked a lot about high and low classes and tracks in this talk, for instance. And so we want to try to practice language like students who are labeled as high or low or whatever. And it's a little awkward and it takes some getting used to, but that's good. And in fact, it should be awkward because part of what the awkwardness does is remind us that these labels are problematic and they're an artifact of a problematic system. And so we want to keep questioning that. All right, to wrap up, and I know this was a fairly long type of lecture for our class, and we won't have a lot that are this long, but I did want to use it to sort of frame how we're going to think about the semester. All right, so to summarize, a lot of people develop intuitions about teaching and education, but they're wrong and really don't match what we know. Well, research can't tell us everything. We do know quite a bit about good teaching. We know that kids learn best through problems and contexts. We know that they need real opportunities to think about messy real world situations. We know that you have to make a choice about how you're going to think about injustices and politics in your classroom, and that choosing to ignore them is just as much a choice as choosing to include them. And there's a growing consensus of the idea that this is something kids really need an opportunity to explore in the math classroom. We know that tracking is detrimental, and especially the language about it around it is very detrimental. And therefore, we're going to practice talking about kids in terms of their strengths. All right, I'm looking forward to continuing to explore these ideas with you throughout the semester.